love his presence. Yes. I tell you, I love his presence. And I know that you're going to love the word today because it's going to bring faith and hope to your life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We're going to be talking about something very basic to our faith, and that's on forgiveness and healing. And you say, well, that's awful basic. I think I know that. Well, let's see if you know that. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, the Son of the living God,
yes,
we submit to you and we rebuke and bind every demonic power of hell in the flesh that would try to rob from your children anything that you want us to have today. I loose the Spirit of God. I loose the Spirit of God to rise up inside of us, give us revelation, give us a visitation, and we will know the truth, and the truth will set us free.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I'm speaking today on forgiveness and healing. We had a good discussion in Sunday school today about healing and how you know the Spirit of God is talking to you, and does he talk, does he give answers, does he give revelation? Yes, he does. Yes, he does. We just have to believe it and accept it and receive forgiveness and healing. Now, when you first heard about forgiveness, just take a minute and think of when you heard for the first time that Jesus would forgive you of all your sins. How did you feel? I'm so excited. I was so, well, actually, the first couple seconds I wasn't, when Jesus spoke to me sitting in church, because I believed in God. I believed in the Bible that it was God's word, and I believed that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. So I thought I was saved. And I was sitting in church. I wanted God. I was hungry for God. And a pastor said at the end of his service, if anybody wants to get saved or join the church, come up front. Well, when he said that word saved, which he never did in that church, and we were in that church about a year and a half, at least, when he said that word saved, I had a vision of myself getting saved as a child at the altar. And God spoke to me and he said, Gloria, do you know you're not saved? I was devastated. What do you mean I'm not saved? I burst out crying. And he said to me, what are you doing? You don't do that in that church. You didn't raise your hands, you didn't worship, and you didn't get saved. Nobody ever got saved that we've seen in the year and a half we were there. But after that first initial shock, I was excited. We eventually left that church. That's why we were excited. We left that church, and we went to a church where they had the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and we got filled with the Holy Spirit, and I grinned so much that first year that my jaws would hurt. And I think, what if my jaws always hurt? They never hurt before. It's because I was always grinning. I was so excited. I was so excited. That's how I felt. Now, some of you kind of morphed into your salvation in the sense that you were sitting in church, you believed in God, you believed in the Word of God, you believed he died on the cross, and then you heard that you had to be born again. And you said, okay, then I'll be born again. I'll give my life to Christ. I'll let him be my Savior. But you missed out something on that initial joy. Maybe after you walked with the Lord for a while, maybe when you get baptized in the Holy Ghost, you went, yes! I don't know. I don't know when your point was, but I'm sure you had joy somewhere along the line that you were saved and you were born again. What a privilege. We knew that God loved the world. You know, we all learned that as kids, most of us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Yes, 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 yes. I know that God loves the world. He died for our sins on the cross. When we discovered we needed a Savior, we needed to be born again, we needed to have the Spirit of God in our life, that changes everything about you. Bible says it like this in Luke 5:21. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Say that with me. Who can forgive sins but God alone? There is no place we can go. We can't sign up for a program. We can't go to Walmart. You know Walmart. You go to Walmart for everything. But you can't go for your sins. There's only one place you can have your sins forgiven. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why he died on the cross. And when you have this revelation and you obey and you confess, Jesus, I personally need you as my Savior. That's when you realize and it hits you. Man, this thing is personal. He loves me. I was married for years before I found out how my mother, unsaved mother, dedicated me to God as a newborn baby. She just reached down and said, God, this is your baby, because he spared my life. And my alcoholic father, who was a drunk, birthed me. You know, you think about that and you go, wow. And then later on in my Christian life, I found out Psalms 139. While I was yet in my mother's womb, God laid his hand on me. You're not here by accident. You're not a mistake. Your parents might have even told you you were a mistake. I didn't know I was going to have another baby. You were kind of a mistake. No, you were never a mistake.
That's true.
God laid his hand on you in your mother's womb. He knows you by name. Your name is written in the palm of his hand. There's something about confessing Christ. 1 John 1:9 says it like this. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. You say, well, what about after I accept Jesus Christ as my Savior and I find out that I realize I sin? Confess again.
Yeah.
Confess again. Ask forgiveness again. He will wash away your sins. When I was a young Christian, I remember that I read in the Bible that, if I can find this page, I'm going to get the reference. James 1:22 says, be a doer of the word and not a hearer only. Be a doer of the word. Not here being a hearer only, deceiving your own self. I heard as a young Christian that the scripture that says, if it were possible, even the very elect would be deceived. And I thought, God, is it possible? Is it possible that one day I could be deceived and lose my soul? And this is when he spoke to me, be a doer of the word. He said, Maria, no devil of hell will be allowed to deceive you. If you hear my word and obey it, I will protect you. I will protect you. If that thought has ever crossed your mind, I wonder if I could ever be deceived. Because we're going to be in some rough waters in these last days. God says, if you believe my word and you obey my word, he said, no one can take you away from me. No one can deceive you. Trust the Lord. Trust the Lord. He is able to keep that which you commit unto him against that day. And you know what? He's kept me a long time. A long time. We've known the Lord 50-some years. But every truth that God has given us on this journey, you know, he will give you continual revelation. We talked about that in Sunday school, about continual revelation in your life. But you know, when he gives you more revelation, he wants you to obey that revelation. He wants you to obey that revelation. Every truth that he gives us, we must obey. He's not asking you to do. do this alone. He said, I will be with you. I will give you power to become the sons of God. I will give you strength and grace. I will protect you. God will be what you need if you want to be a Christian. I remember one time going through a trial in my Christian life, I felt like I was under attack of the enemy. I couldn't even pray right. But I remember saying this, God, I want to be kept. God, I want to be kept. That's all I could pray, but he kept me. He kept me. He brought me through that trial. You can be in a trial for your soul, but if you pray that word, God, I want to be kept. I want to be kept. He knows how to keep you. He is able to keep that which you committed to him against that day. The Bible is our roadmap to heaven and how to tell us how to live on this earth. I'm sure if you believe that the Bible is the word of God speaking right out of his mouth, instructing people to write that book. I know that if you believe with your heart that the Bible is the word of God, you would read it because that's your roadmap. He will tell you how to live. He will teach you how he loves you. He will help you. He will help you. Do you read your Bible? Oh, I believe that the Bible is the word of God. Well, you know we're going to be judged by these books. It's important that you read the Bible. How are you going to know if you're doing right or wrong? You must read the Bible. Oh, I believe that the Bible is God's word. Well, what has God said to you this week? I don't know. I didn't read it. I don't know. Somehow that's a contradiction. If you want to be saved and you want to stay saved, you have to get to know the author of the book. I can say, I believe this book. I believe this book. You can come to church and say, oh, that was a good sermon. But do you know the author? Do you know who wrote this book? The Bible says that the Bible was written for our growth, for our understanding, that we would know the Lord. Do you want to know more? Do you want to grow? Do you want to be saved? So many Christians want forgiveness. There's so much more. If all I lived off of is what I did when I was 21 years old, I don't think I would be here today. I would not be preaching the gospel. This is not a one-time experience. This is a life's journey. You have to be serious about your salvation. You have to be serious about God because God is serious about us.
Yeah.
He is serious about us.
Yeah.
He wants to be a part of our everyday life. He wants to be a part of our spiritual needs, our physical needs, our financial needs, our emotional needs. But if we make a one-time experience and we say, I want you, Jesus, to be my Savior, and then I take care of my spiritual needs, my physical needs, my emotional needs. If I try to do that, my financial needs, I'm not letting him be a part of my life. He wants to be a part of your life. He wants to be the Lord of your life. Well, if I let him be Lord, that's like admitting I'm dumb. I can't do anything. I have to have help on everything. Well, guess what? I need help on everything. I pray like that's why the Bible says pray about everything. You think he was kidding when he said that, right? Pray about everything. Well, God, I lost my glasses. I'll tell you what's bad. When you lose your glasses and you're looking for them, you're on your head. That's pretty bad.
Did he tell you where they were? Yep, he did.
Let me tell you something. God wants to be a part of your life. It's not a one-time experience. Well, I was confirmed when I was 10. I accepted Christ as my Savior when I was 12. Well, are you serving him now? Do you know the author in a personal way? He wants you to get to know him personally. What about your physical needs? What in the world before for our physical needs. Aren't we of doctors, hospitals, medicines, painkillers, you name it, they have a pill for everything. I am thankful for caring doctors, loving nurses, EMTs that you can call to bring an ambulance to rescue. I'm thankful for them. But you're not going to grow in your Christian life and in your faith until you believe all of the Bible, not just part of it. Psalms 103, 3 and 4 says that God forgives all our sins and that God heals all our diseases and that He redeems our life from destruction. See, I can believe, you can believe that God forgives us of all our sins. What about the rest of it? What about, do I believe He heals all my diseases? Do I believe that He redeems my life from destruction? How many of you have ever, you can raise your hand on this one, how many of you have ever been near a car accident so close that you cried out and said, Jesus? How many has that ever happened to you? That's happened to us. And I mean, He spared us from a serious, serious accident many times over. Jesus, just His name. You don't have time to say, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. It's Jesus. It's His name. There's power in the name of Jesus. James 5, 14 and 15 says it like this. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed any sins, they shall be forgiven. You say, well, you know, I was raised in the church. They didn't believe in that stuff. I don't really care. What does the Bible say? What does the Bible say? See, the Bible, we say we believe in the Bible. What does the Bible say? If any is sick among you, let him pray. If any is sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church. Let them anoint them with oil. And the prayer of faith will save the sick. What can we learn from these scriptures? God saving us, forgiving us, healing us, redeeming us. What can we learn? One thing you can learn, that God loves you. You know, God doesn't stammer. I've heard my husband say this several times. God doesn't stammer. If you need him, you do. No, He says, if you're sick, pray. If you need forgiveness, ask for it. Confess it. Ask for it. You can learn that God wants you to grow in your faith. You know, when I first got saved and I heard about healing, I was amazed. I thought it was good enough, great enough to be forgiven. But then I heard that He wanted to heal me. Then I heard that He would heal my emotions and my memories. I go, oh my goodness, you do that too? I mean, I was astounded. But you know what? As He spoke to me from the Bible, and in my heart, I believed it. But you have to act on what you say you believe. You have to act on it. Did you know that sin can cause sickness? Did you know that bitterness and resentment and unforgiveness and anger has been proved by doctors to cause sickness? You know why? They say it's not what you eat, but what's eating you. Sometimes people have things inside of them that's eating away. They can't forgive so-and-so. They're angry at someone else. They're bitter at somebody else. Don't you realize that's eating at your body and at your emotions and at your spirit? everything. And if you have bitterness or anger or resentment or unforgiveness in your life, if I was you, I would get rid of it. Quick. Otherwise, you're going to find out that sickness begins to take hold of your body, begins to eat away at your insides. Isaiah 53:5 says this, "By his stripes we are healed." Now you could say, well, you know, that's nice. That's nice. Do you know what those stripes meant? It meant when the Romans took a whip, they didn't just whip those people. They put glass and metal on the edges of those whips. And when they whipped, they ripped. When they whipped, they ripped. Didn't Jesus pay enough for your sins? Didn't he pay enough for your healing? Didn't he pay enough? Do you want him to pay more? Well, he won't, because it's done. He said to his Father on the cross, "It is finished. It is finished." By believing the word that God has given to us, we will grow in our faith. If you are at the same faith level now that you were when you first became a Christian, you're somewhere wrong. And you need to ask questions. What is wrong with me? Why am I not growing? I've talked to my husband, has talked to many people over the years that they get stuck. And they can't seem to pray. They can't seem to move on. They can't seem to grow as a Christian. They're stuck. You need to ask questions. Why am I stuck? Don't be surprised at what he tells you. Don't be surprised that a person's face comes to your mind. You need to forgive. You need to let go. You need to let me heal you of that. I can take away your pain. I can take away the hurt in your emotions. We need to be growing Christians. Remember, it's not a one-time experience when you're 10 or 12 years old. It is a lifetime journey.
Yeah.
Can you imagine getting to heaven? You wouldn't like it anyhow. Because if you did that and you've never grown, you would not like heaven. You wouldn't. Because all they want to do there is worship and worship God. All they want to do there is live pure and right. All they want, you wouldn't even like heaven. It would be hell to you. But if you're a growing Christian and you're loving the Lord and he's answering your prayers, do you know how many prayers he answers for us?
Amen.
He answers so many prayers. We can thank him from now to eternity just for the prayers he's already answered.
Amen.
What a good God. There is a song out today called "Good, Good God." He's a good, good God. He's a good, good God. That's who he is. That's who he is. I love that song. I'm trying to get the music for that right now. He's a good, good God. That's who he is. That's who he is. I'm loved by him. That's who I am. That's who I am. Whether you believe it or not, he loves you dearly. I don't care what your parents told you. I don't care what your exes told you. I don't care what anybody told you. You are loved by God.
Yeah.
And you know what the Bible says? He cannot deny himself.
Uh-huh.
Even if you don't believe in him, he can't deny himself. He is who he said he is. I think it would be much more fun if we believed him. Don't you? It would be a lot more fun. Bible tells us to ask, seek, and knock. See, there's a lot of questions about healing. And what the enemy wants to do is get you stuck. Well, I prayed for healing, and he didn't heal me. I guess he doesn't love me. I guess he doesn't want to heal me. Ask, seek. You're supposed to go to the next level. You're supposed to start asking questions. You're supposed to start studying the Bible. What does God say? He says, "I am the Lord that healeth thee."
Mm-hmm.
By my stripes you are healed. Well, I prayed. I prayed a lot, and I had people lay hands on me. I was anointed with oil, and nothing happened. Ask questions. See, what does His Word say? See, He wants us to grow. And sometimes He didn't say no. He's just delaying the answer. So that you seek Him. So that you love Him. So that you need Him. Us human beings are so fickle, I don't even know why He bothers with us. But we're His creation. And He loves us. And He's kind and loving and patient. And He says, would you seek me? No, that's too much like work. Well, was it too much like work for Jesus to be beat and die on the cross and be rejected? Not because of His sins, but for our sins. Our sins. What are the questions you have about healing? Well, I prayed 3 times and nothing happened. Well, I prayed 4 times. Well, did you study the Bible in the meantime? Did you study scriptures on healing in the meantime? Did you ask questions in the meantime? Is there sin in your life? No, there's no sin in my life. I'm a Christian. There's no sin in my life. Listen, I'm saved a long time. Sin creeps in very sneakily into our lives. You need to examine your heart and ask God to examine your heart. You don't want sin in your life to stop you from growing. You don't want sin to keep you from being healed. He said, I will heal you and I will forgive your sins. He knows us. There's no good thing in us. If we can go 1 day, 2 days, 3 days without sinning, man, we think we got a man. Let me tell you something. We can live every day for the Lord.
Yes.
We do not have to sin. But I don't expect a newborn Christian to know what I know. I don't expect them to have the faith that I have. I've gone through some hard knocks to get to the place I am. God doesn't expect you to know what a mature Christian is, but He expects you to grow. He expects you to learn. He expects you to ask questions. He expects you to know this book. We're going to be judged by this book. It's important that we study it and we read it. I had an experience with blood sugar problems that I want to share with you, and the reason I'm sharing it is to show you how the enemy wants to take advantage of our down experiences. A couple months ago, I don't know, when was it, a year ago? I don't know. They found out that I have diabetes, I have blood sugar problems. And they wanted me to go on certain medications. I said, no, I would rather do it with changing my diet, eating right. Because immediately, God spoke to me. He said, Maria, self-control is one of the fruits of the Spirit. I don't know what he was saying. I love sweets. I love sweets. And my husband loves me to bake. Honey, we're out of cookies. Honey, I need a pie. Honey, you know. And so, he doesn't get diabetes, I get it, because I eat what he wants. I love sweets. And so the Lord really began to deal with me about eating right. So I told the doctor, I said, no, I said, I'll get the little tester, and I'll keep track of what's going on, but I'm going to change my diet. And I had the church pray for me. Within weeks, I was down so good and so normal. I was so excited. I had a testimony. God healed me. Well, then around Christmas holidays, I got a little careless. My blood sugar level started to go back up. God said, I told you. Self-control. Okay, God, I'm sorry. And I had to repent again. See, you can be a Christian, but still have to repent. I don't want anything to be between the Lord and my life. I want to be clear in my testimony. So, I began to watch. Ever since Christmas, I've been really watching, trying to do good. My blood sugar levels were just going goofy. I thought, what in the world? So I got prayed for again and came down some, and it just was giving me a fit. I'm there, Lord, now what's going on? I was laying in bed just the other day, and I always lay in bed and pray for about an hour and a half, even before I get out of bed. And I got up, tested my blood sugar, and it was up high. I said, okay, that was it. I went back to bed and I said, God, show me what's going on here. And he had been telling me, you know how sometimes God speaks to you and it's kind of quiet and you hear it, but it doesn't sink in? And he kept saying, Satan is trying to steal your testimony. So I went back to bed and I heard that again. I said, that is it. If this is coming from an attack of the enemy, and he's attacking me with the spirit of infirmity, trying to ruin my testimony, I rebuke you in Jesus' name. I jumped out of bed and took my blood sugar down again. I went down again. Went back to bed. I thought, I'm going to test it again. It's hard on your fingers. But I got up and I tested it again. It went down again. And it went down again. I tested it four or five times. I thought, I didn't eat. I didn't do anything. I just kept testing and praying. I thought, oh my goodness, that was an attack. Let me tell you something. Sometimes we go through things that don't quit. There's a battle, and you know it. There's a battle. You're going to have to fight that with supernatural weapons. You're going to have to believe with your heart, God is a good God. He's a good, good God. That's who he is. I'm loved by him, and that's who I am. And he says, I am the Lord that healeth thee. He means it.
Yeah.
But you know what it is? I've been asking. Take me to a new level in my faith. I remember Maritza saying this last week. She said, if we're going to pray that, we have to be ready. That's true. Because you're going to get tested. But just because you're tested and your answers don't come right away, does not mean that God doesn't love you and that he's not going to or doesn't want to answer. He wants to answer, but he wants you to grow. He wants you to eat this book. He wants you to live it. He wants you to believe it. He wants you to let it get inside of you. And only he can do that. He has to help us. He has to, we have to say, we talked about this in Sunday school, you have to say, God, get the word in me. Give me revelation. Give me revelation. If you're going through a battle, give me revelation. What is happening here? What is going on? God, I'm your child. I am not leaving you, and I know you're not going to leave me. You hang on, and you seek God. If you think we're in battles now, you wait. This is not going to get easier. We're in crazy battles. No, I wouldn't say. I was going to say what Delbert and Michelle seen in Chicago. No, I'm not going to say it. But the thing of it is, there is stuff going on. You want to know? Ask them. But you know what? God says, I'm in charge. You say, God, if you're in charge, why do you let all this happen? Because he's letting people have what they want, not what he wants to have. He's letting people have what they want. Don't ever let it be said of your life that God says, okay, if that's what you want, you can have it. Go for it. But he's not in it. Listen, I don't want any decision made in my life that God is not in it. I want God a part of everything in my life. Is God in your life? Is the spirit of the living? Do you know how powerful God is? Well, if he puts his spirit inside of us, close your eyes. Close your eyes. Look inside. Is the spirit of God inside of you? And if he's inside of you, do you know what that means? The power and the authority that he's given you? Are you using it? Okay, you can open your eyes. Are you using what he gave you? There's a statement that says, use it or lose it. You can choose to grow in God, or you can choose to disobey. You can choose to get stuck and not let God get you unstuck, which he wants to. He wants you to be a powerful, anointed servant of God that lets his light shine, that you are the salt of the earth, that people come up to your life and say, I want what you have. That's what he wants for you. He wants you to be a blessing to this world. That the reason our nation is in the way it is because people have not obeyed the word. They have not done what God told them to do. They have not lived They have not raised up godly leaders. Greed and violence and immorality has so taken over our nation, nothing is going to stop it except God. And He can. Let me tell you something. If you need to understand, read some of the stories in the Old Testament. I've been reading through Joshua and how the armies would come against Israel, and they were outnumbered five times more than what the Israelites had. But they called upon God, and they were wiped out by God. God can do anything. You've got to call upon the Lord. You've got to obey. You want to be a doer of the word and not a hearer only? If that's true of you, you have to make new commitments. Do you need a different kind of faith to be healed that you do to be forgiven? No. No, it's the same faith. Faith is faith. And God honors faith. What is faith? Faith is trusting in the character. That's why He wants you to get to know Him. Because He wants you to trust His character. He wants you to trust who He is. He's not going to change. He loves you. Be obedient. Allow the Lord to move in your life. I would like us to all stand. I want us to make commitments to God. Let's all stand. Let's make commitments to God. He's not asking you to be an overcoming, victorious Christian without His help.
That's true.
You can't do it. I can't do it. You don't know. I would never, ever be preaching the gospel and be bold in preaching the gospel if God wouldn't have saved me and changed my heart and my life. I was so fearful. I wouldn't have stood up in front of crowds for nothing. But the power of God. The power of God. Let's pray. Close your eyes and let's pray together. Father, in Jesus' name, help me,
Lord,
to realize what I have inside me by Your Spirit. Give me revelations of that. And when I get stuck, and You want me to go to a new level, help me to cry out to You. Get Your help. And pray about everything. Lord, I just give myself to You. And Lord, You know the needs in my body. Heal me, Lord. It's the same faith. It's the same faith that I use to be saved. You gave me faith, period.
Amen.
Help me to use that faith right. In Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. Are you ready for the blessing of the Lord to come upon you now? All right. May the blessing of the Lord come upon you. May His faith shine upon you now. May the comfort of the Holy Spirit comfort you, that empowers you, equips you, and may you walk in the peace of the knowledge of God and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you. You are blessed. You are blessed.
Amen. You are blessed.
God, hallelujah. Glory to God.